Okay, it's 8 o'clock. I wanted to thank everybody for taking some time out of their evening to join us and watch this really informative webinar podcast. This is Rachel's third time with us. And for those of you who don't know Rachel, Rachel Trobman is the CEO of Upside Health. She is a resource. She has a vast knowledge about coding, the latest and I guess greatest in remote patient monitoring and codes. And, you know, whether or not you're just starting this or you've been doing this, you could pick her brain. She really knows a lot about this stuff. I always have lots of questions to ask her. And it's always a pleasure to talk to Rachel. Welcome to the podcast. And thank you for joining us.
Thanks for having me back, David.
So before we get into Rachel's presentation, she has a lot to inform us about. A few reminders, we do have some pain management courses coming up, board review course in June, as well as ultrasound courses. So just check out the pain exam events page for all the details. Rachel, why don't you take it away?
Sounds good. Can you re-enable screen sharing for me?
Of course. Of course. Okay, you have it.
Got it. Thank you. So good evening, everyone. I'm excited about everything that I'm going to share with you all today. Just a quick notice, I am neither an attorney nor a doctor, and I don't play either one on webinars. Everything that I'm speaking today is based off of my background building digital health products, specifically for those in pain and for clinicians who treat chronic pain and pain patients. I've worked really closely with CMS, AMA, and even the Digital Health Alliance to build a lot of the codes that I'm going to be talking about today. And I wanted to start a little bit of background for those of you who haven't been on any of the previous sessions, or even those who have, but are a bit confused by all this alphabet soup. So this all started about 10 years ago when CMS decided to start creating a whole new set of codes for chronic care management. So specifically for patients with multiple chronic health conditions who are being treated by primary care as a way to compensate clinicians for all of the extra care time that these patients required in hopes that they would be giving them more touch points. And they primarily involved utilizing nursing services or external nursing services to stay in touch with the patient between visits and to prevent increased hospitalizations, ER visits, et cetera. It moved beyond just traditional chronic care cases into behavioral health with the CCO, these collaborative care and BHI codes that were released in 2016 through 2018. And then in 2019, things started to get even more interesting with the creation of RPM, remote physiologic monitoring. And so remote physiologic monitoring is the monitoring or measurement using an FDA-approved device, so not a Fitbit or an Apple Watch, of blood pressure, heart rate, pulse ox, HRV. And there needs to be a minimum of 16 days, a month of recordings. This can be done by a third-party service under the general supervision. But really, last year, things got even more interesting, especially in the pain space, because whereas RPM was sometimes difficult to find physiologic measurements to be used regularly by pain patients, RTM was specifically for MSK and pulmonary, and it included therapeutic monitoring. So that means medication adherence, it could be patient-reported data. It just opened up the opportunity for remote care to be used in this space. And
Rachel,
then,
is it safe to assume the pandemic accelerated these codes, or was it going to happen anyway?
I mean, I think the pandemic accelerated all aspects of remote and digital care. it increased, obviously, reimbursement for telehealth, of which a lot of that is stayed. It made patients much more comfortable with remote care and digital therapeutics, digital tools that came for their patients, and particularly in the cases where patients were coming in every single month, but didn't necessarily need to, you know, this helped better triage their care. And then last year's physician fee schedule, there were 10 pages or so dedicated to changing or creating codes for chronic pain, understanding that that chronic pain care is very time consuming, is very complicated, and requires a lot of touch points for the clinicians. But there was no clear concrete recommendation or any sort of codes. Well, that changed this year. And so really that's what we're going to be talking about today, is these new CPM codes, just like these other fun RPM, RTM, CTM, BHI, let's add CPM to the mix. And that's really what I'm talking about today. And CPM is made up of two new G codes, G3002 and G3003. And G3002 is the main one. It is for chronic pain, so persistent pain lasting for 3 months or more. It is about utilizing an integrated multimodal care. It's considered a bundled payment code. So you're not going to be reimbursed for each different item that you, the time that you spend for each different thing, but rather offering this integrated care plan for your patients. But it's up to the physician to determine which of the items, and I'm going to show you this menu of options that have been offered, is best for them, is best for your patient. It's also not condition specific. So there's not a specific ICD code that needs to be associated with the patient for you to bill it. It just needs that noted that the patient has chronic pain.
So this is a separate code that you're billing when you're reviewing data. That's not, you could bill the same day as a visit or a different day, correct? Mm-hmm. So you bill your regular follow-up visit 99213, and then this is a code on top of that.
Yep, we'll get into it. Yeah, in 1 minute, I'm going to talk a little bit about the requirements for billing and how and when it gets billed, but you're correct. So as I mentioned, this menu of components are all included in what CMS defines as, you know, multidisciplinary integrative multimodal care. So that includes everything from a diagnosis, assessment and monitoring, administrating validated screen tools, health literacy counseling, medication management, care coordination or with the physical therapist, crisis care management, behavioral health coordination, and then of course, development administration of patient-centered care plans with specific goals and outcomes. Now, for most physicians, specifically the pain physicians that may be on this call, this is part of your typical care. Like this is not anything, I think for the most part, it's like absorbent. But all of these different things take time to deploy and to do. And so that's what these codes are meant to offer. But there's a couple of requirements around how they can be offered. So the first encounter, in order to bill these codes, you must have at least an initial face-to-face encounter in a clinical setting for at least 30 minutes by a physician or qualified healthcare professional. So you can't start billing these codes unless this patient has already had their initial intake. And there must be a minimum of 30 minutes per month, per patient, by the physician or another qualified healthcare professional for these codes to be billed. This is separate
from the office. 30 minutes, you mean?
So it doesn't have to be in the office. So it's this could be data review. This could be a check-in with the patient. This could be documentation. This could be calling a physical therapist or checking on a referral. That all counts.
But it says face-to-face, so you actually need to be with the patient on the line on video call for 30 minutes?
That patient must have had a clinical encounter. So your first interaction with the patient had to be a 30-minute visit.
Oh, for the first visit?
Yes.
But ongoing minimum of 30 minutes per month. Okay, so you're saying ongoing, you're doing 30 minutes of review or whatever per month. It doesn't have to be every time you see them for 30 minutes. That's...
Correct. And it's that first, like, think about it as like, you've had to set up parameters with this patient at some point to know that this patient is going to need this complex care. The other thing, just a quick note, go back for a sec. Unlike RTM and RPM, which if you're familiar with them, the patient can only be using one RPM or RTM program at a time across all their providers. Well, more than one provider per month can bill these codes for that patient. So if the patient is having medication management done by their primary care doctor, and then you're doing interventional, but also some behavioral health components, you both can bill 3002 for that same patient every month.
That's great.
G3003 is the X code, so to speak. It's the additional 15 minutes per patient per month by a qualified healthcare professional. Again, this review, it's the addition, like think about like the first 30 minutes were spent on this, and then this patient required additional touch points or additional review additional data. Each 15-minute increment, you can bill G3003. There's unlimited times it can be billed. I mean, I don't imagine patients, you know, spending five hours, but knowing that that exists there is important. These codes can be billed. So when I said they're bundled services or a bundled payment, it's for offering all the service, but those individual services or those individual attributes can be billed alongside these codes. So it doesn't mean that if you're billing 3002, you can't then bill 98977, which and 98980, which are the RTM codes, or you can't bill 99484. So just look at those as some of like the check boxes that you can put next to it that justify billing 3002. So reimbursement is approximately $80 per patient per month for 3002 and about $30 for 3003. This is not, you know, one time for one patient going to change the practice, but when deploying solutions across the board, it starts building a budget, so to speak, for deploying these solutions and for whatever additional time that deploying these solutions take. Because we all know that even if you're working with a third party like ours to do the RTM and the behavioral health and the care management, it still is going to create additional time for your team and your staff, even the best company. And so you're kind of looking at these codes as helping support that. So a few key takeaways: one, document, right? I mean, there's going to come, we all want to make sure that, you know, clawbacks and whatnot never happen and audits never happen. But in the case that they do, you know, effective documentation is key. And if you're working with, you know, any sort of remote care partner, or RTM, RPM partner, having this documentation is important. And a lot of times they can help you with that.
When, you mentioned RTM partner, like your company, for instance. So basically how does it integrate with the practice, like the service that you provide to help the practices get off the ground?
So we actually have a product called Branch Health, and Branch Health is remote care for pain care. And so we utilize a variety of services and tools to help practices scale remote care and do so in a reimbursable way. And so that we're making sure that based off the patient, they're getting the right suite of offerings at the right time, and that you as a practice are getting all of the data that you can use to better manage your care, to spend your time on, you know, at the highest degree of your specialty, and take the rest off your hands.
And practically speaking, who is reviewing the data? The doctor, the nurse, your team?
Great question. So as part of, so RTM and RPM can be offered under the NBHI, actually can be offered under the general supervision of the prescribing clinician, so your office. So our team of nurses, and then we have like pain psychologists, physical therapists, whatnot, are the ones reviewing the data that's coming in through RTM and BHI and all that whatnot, and then preparing notes and submitting them for documentation. But you need to sign off on them. Your practice needs to sign off on them, and you need to review them, right, to sign off on them. So that's where this component comes in.
So just practically speaking, patient comes in, I explain the program, mm-hmm. and then we have the data come in through, either it goes directly to your team or to my nurse or whoever, the mm-hmm. report's compiled or the note is compiled. And then I basically look at it to see, okay, you know, nothing new, sign off, or, oh, look, this one's having issues with their meds or depressed or this or that. And then you take action, you document taking action.
Correct. And I mean, a lot of it is creating new talking points with the patients of things that you might not know, right? Like our team is spending 60 minutes on the phone with these patients sometimes each month. So we're getting a lot of color that's not falling into your office, but we've also been able to identify patients in the middle of like a pain crisis, you know, post procedure, because we can touch base with them on a more regular basis. And we can also visualize and help you tell a story with them of the progress that they're seeing or the challenges through not just patient reported validated screening tools, but we use things like distance traveled based off of GPS coordinates and step count and HRV. So there's a lot of other data measurements that we're pulling in. But again, like we look at what we offer as a layer of your service that allows you to do what you do best, even better, and create new growth streams while doing it. But in no way do we ever want to see ourselves replacing what you do well. And so none of these codes are like replacing visit codes, you know, unless, of course, you want to find those patients that might not really need monthly visits and replace those visits with new patient visits or procedure visits or whatnot, without, you know, losing touch with those patients. So that's what we do really well.
Interesting.
The other, you know, key takeaway that I see here is just that, you know, the time spent supporting, you know, these new digital health or virtual healthcare offerings count towards those. So now we can start deploying these other solutions, as I mentioned, in a way that doesn't hinder your practice, but instead helps grow it. And I know you and I, David, were talking about this before, but one of the things I did want to note is, you know, one other change in the physician fee schedule in regards to RTM. When RTM was first released, unlike RPM, so remember RTM is therapeutic monitoring, RPM physiologic monitoring. When RTM was first released, it was only offered under direct supervision, which made it really difficult in many times for practices to offer it, because you're not going to spend another 20 minutes at least per patient per month and then call them the face to review the data. It just became clunky. Under the public health emergency, there was an exception that it could be offered under general supervision. Well, as of 2023, RTM is now officially able to be offered under general supervision, which then makes deploying it the same as RPM. You can use third-party resources to support that.
We have a bunch of questions which we could get to after presentation.
No, but I mean, that's pretty much it. I was just calling attention to some examples of these like virtual care offering or digital health tools that are called out in this remote care, you know, how to provide your patients with the criteria of CPM. And these are all ways in which there are tools out there. Many of them are on branch, actually all of them. But there are others as well, not just us. And so I just think that it just creates a lot of opportunity, and it might not be 100% of your patients you're going to spend this amount of time on. Or it might be, you know, once it becomes, but the key is making whatever change that you do fully integrated in your practice. So it doesn't feel like some, like when it becomes part of your workflow, everyone drives the most value.
Right. I know I'm a pain doctor who does more of the physiologic monitoring for patients on opiates. Yes. So he doesn't want to do it for everyone. He doesn't want to overutilize the service, but so he has a strict criteria. If you're on opiates or at least a certain, you know, morphine equivalent, mm-hmm. he will implement this. And this is how we can document that people are not having issues with breathing or over sedation, et cetera. Before we get into the questions, one more thing I want to add or ask. So when it, just the practicality of this whole thing, mm-hmm. patients are feeding information into an app. I'm not talking about the physiologic monitoring where they monitor their blood pressure at home or whatever. I'm talking about the actual data that you look at. They're collecting it by entering things into an app, or is there some other way?
Are you talking about on branch, or are you talking about?
I'm talking about branch. Like when you do the data collection, how are you getting this data?
So just like RPM. So our platform actually works two ways. So we work with a heart rate variance monitor where we can actually pull data directly, like a blood pressure cuff. But instead of pulling it directly into a dashboard, it comes through our app first. So that way we can gather more color. And we do the same thing with other passively collected measurements. But then we also do ask patient-reported outcome measures on pain interference, pain intensity, pain and function, pain and behavior. We ask about sleep.
When you say we ask, are you calling them to ask, or is it?
Got it. So it's actually a little bit of both. So we have both like a high touch, low touch option. So patients do enter this information in a mobile application. Works on smartphone and tablet, but then we also do have a human component as part of all of this.
Got it. All right, so we have some questions from the attendees.
Okay, let me.
The first, can you see them on your end?
Yes.
Okay. So well, I'll read them to everybody else.
I said, thank you, Maxime. I am looking, so I see, does G3003 mean every 15-minute increment? So a 45 minutes could be billed three times. Yes. So it's every 15-minute increment after 30 minutes. So 30 minutes, at least 30 minutes, right? Like 30, you have to have at least 30 minutes is 3002. And then 3003 is the incremental time.
So this is if, but you're still looking at the data. You're talking about if you need to spend extra time dealing with the data and maybe.
Well, it's not looking at the data. It's not just that. I mean, the data is one component of it.
The data generates, it triggers a phone call, which triggers extra time to be spent coordinating care or dealing with the patient. And that's what 35 minutes comes in, correct?
Coordinating care, delivering educational materials, whatever, reviewing goals, whatever the different components of, that you pick constitutes this patient's ideal care plan. It could be, let's say the patient is having a pain crisis and you have to spend some time like readjusting their medication or getting them into an appointment sooner, right? Whatever back-end infrastructure is involved is all part of this care. It's the idea that you are managing this patient's care, and this patient's care is more than just managing it in the one time that they're in the office, but throughout the month.
I wish we could bill for the time we spend on hold with the insurance companies. Too bad we can't do that. Okay.
I see. So I see, given the G3002 code is billed once a month, is the 30 minutes spent reviewing documentation supposed to be in one sitting over the course of the month in which the code was billed? Yeah, so it's not, I mean, it doesn't necessarily be in one sitting, and it's not just the review of documentation, but it's billed per calendar. It can be billed once per calendar month. So there's not a specific time limitation. Hopefully
and this covers the time that your staff, for instance, hypothetically, if we use branch, would be reviewing the data or compiling it, plus the physician's review time, or is it just the physician's review time? Like, I mean,
so it has nothing to do with, so our time is billable under general supervision under the RPM, RTM, BHI code. So we have our own sets of codes. This is the time that you need to spend signing off, billing, signing off on these notes, reviewing those notes that were sent, and taking action off of them. So I
get a report from you, but let's say everything's cool, no major issues, takes me 5 minutes to review. I still could bill the level two code, the G3002 code, or no? Do I need to spend more time, or?
It depends what other care management you've had to do for the patient in that month. If it takes you 2 seconds and it took you no time to onboard the patient for them, like, then no, it's going to be hard to justify. But I know that there's a lot that goes into supporting these patients month over month.
Right.
And that, like, reviewing the data. And there's going to be patients where, yeah, some patients, yes, there's going to be very little to do.
Right. So if that's the case, or?
No. No, but you're going to be billing the RTM codes and what, like, so you're still probably billing $240 per patient per month, not 110.
And can you review which codes were those again, the RTM codes?
So RTM is 98975 for the first time, 98977, 98980, 98981.
Okay.
There is, so I see, is Upside Health accepted by all insurance companies like Blue Cross Blue Shield, Medicare, Medicaid, workers' comp? Great question, Dr. Ramos. So it really varies from state to state what the coverage looks like. Medicare, yes, 100%. Again, these are not Upside Health specific codes or Branch Health specific codes. These are standard CMS codes that we're helping unlock, so to speak. We're providing the services that make these codes attainable and easier. Medicaid, varying from state to state. Workers' comp, we have workers' comps that have been reimbursing at 100% and others that haven't. We pre-auth all patients before determining which pathway of our product they use. So we have a version of our product that everyone can use and is not a per patient per month fee. And then Blue Cross Blue Shield, again, state dependent. So I'm happy, like, with any practice that's interested in learning more to put together, you know, for them based off of their patient demographic or their payer mix, what that looks like. WRVU is associated with these codes. The G codes, I am not 100% sure. I will follow up on that for sure. I'll be the first to admit when I don't know. But there are RVUs associated with RPM, RTM, and BHI. And I could pull those numbers afterwards. And then HRV and pulse data, sleep data, that is very true. The Dr. Ramos has talked about, you know, the variability of this data. A couple of things to note is it has to be an FDA approved device, not a wellness device that's gathering the data, which definitely limits and levels the playing field a little bit. In regards to what we use, so our LEAF device, it's more about the patient's individual variability over time than in what is one specific reading. And we have data upon activity, but what we use it as one metric amongst a group of measurements. I'm trying to get through all of these and also be respectful for everyone's time because we're at the half hour. I will, if I didn't get to your question, I will follow up and make sure that I can get to it. But David, do you have any, I know that you like have a, you normally have a sign off. I want to make sure that you get to everything as well.
Yeah, no, I mean, I want to make sure that you said, you know, everything you came to talk about and that everybody's questions were answered for the most part. I think there was just one question we missed, but I think it was pretty much explained already. The advantage of these codes on top of the usual 99212 codes or whatever, just an added service, and it may be advantageous for patients who are on opiate therapy or may need a little more tighter monitoring. And at least now we can bill for it and get paid. I think you know, it was pretty clear what you said. Still confusing in terms of like all these new codes and how to do it, but
I would really like to step in, right? It's just like helping you understand if it makes sense for your practice, how you can optimize it, and how you can use the data in many ways. So how do we start using this promise data that's being collected from the app for insurance documentation? How do we use it? How do we use these outcome measurements for other things? How do we use the service of having a nurse call the patients every month to identify patients that would benefit from another procedure? You know, all those things are like layers of an onion that just come as we roll these out and work with new partners and do so in a meaningful way.
Yeah. Can you customize the questions? Can you start to ask if I'm trying to like for a specific group of patients, just want to know something, for instance, patients who have spinal stenosis, epidurals or mild procedure, and I want to know how many blocks they walk every day. Can we add that or change that?
So we have a whole library of validated screening tools that we roll out and kind of pick and choose either with ourselves or with our partners that we work with. But then we're also gathering a ton of just patient insights. And one of the values that the practices that we work with find is that, yes, we're taking this data in, but we're not a pure RPM, RTM solution where we're taking this data in, calling the patient and just spitting it back out to you. We have modules on our platform that respond to the patient's particular challenges. So we have mindfulness, art therapy, movement, pain education, pain psychology, sleep hygiene, moderate peer support. Like we have a whole army of experts that have created content that patients can use for self-management in between visits that adds a whole other layer to their care, and that keeps the patients really sticky and involved because they want to give more data so that they can get more insights. And then also we have these nurses checking in as we have this free text to be able to help step in. And it's pretty incredible. Like, I mean, these nurses, these patients, they have like a text conversation, right? Like there's ways to gather this data that is not always possible within the confines of a traditional medical practice, but doesn't mean
that it can't ask things, or I'm sorry to interrupt, but patients always forget to ask things or report things sometimes.
Exactly. And that's where it is. And that we, instead of them calling the office just to like check in, right? Like we have this all in a nice, organized way. And that's where we like to be supportive. So, I mean, thank you, everyone. I think I got to every question. If I didn't, again, I'll scan over it afterwards and we'll follow up.
Anything else? How can I find you, Rachel?
Rachel at upside.health is one of the easiest ways to get me. I think I have a slide. Yep. So Rachel at upside.health. I can also be, or just go to upside.health and click the contact or grab some time on my calendar, and I'm pretty available.
That's great. Thank you, Rachel. Thank you, everybody, for taking time out of your busy evenings. Thank you, Rachel, and Upside Health. More to come. Take care. And you'll see the show notes where Rachel's contacts will be, contact information will be, and you can reach out to her there.
All right.
Thank you.